Steppin Out is made possible in part by Susie and Pierre G. Villery.
With a continued passion for public television, we are proud to underwrite Steppin Out.
Please join us in supporting WYES Television.
The New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation promotes, preserves, and perpetuates music, culture, and heritage through programs, cultural, educational, and economic activities year-round. Learn more at jazzandheritage.org. The American Italian Cultural Center and Museum on South Peters in New Orleans offers event venue space, Italian language classes, dual citizenship and translation services, seminars, genealogy, and trips to Italy. Ciao, AmericanItalianCulturalCenter.com. This program is brought to you in part by the Eugenie and Joseph Jones Family Foundation, a local foundation proud to support education, the arts, and culture in the greater New Orleans area.
I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin' Out with updates from the local restaurant, arts, and entertainment scenes. Joining me, Dook Chase, owner and executive chef of Dooky Chase's Restaurant, and heading the family cooking team to be showcased in the brand new WYES series, the Dooky Chase Kitchen, Leah's Legacy. Welcome, Dook,
Thank
to
you.
Our table.
Thank you for having me.
It's great to see you. Hello. And Vance Vaucresson making his Steppin' Out debut, president and CEO of Vaucresson Sausage and Creole Deli. Welcome, Vance. Hello. And there's some wonderful connections here too, yeah. We'll share with you. And of course, Alan Smason,
of course.
Editor of the Crescent City Jewish News and TheaterCriticism.com, and Poppy returns next week. But before we visit with Dook, here's a taste of what you can expect from the Dooky Chase Kitchen series.
Established in 1941 in the Treme neighborhood of New Orleans, Dooky Chase is recognized as one of the most culturally significant restaurants in the country. Chef Leah Chase, who led the restaurant until her passing in 2019, put Creole food on the international map.
You're not cooking anything in Miss Leah's kitchen if you don't have butter.
I'm fifth generation in the kitchen, and I'm so grateful to come here and, you know, make classic dishes that my grandmother fixed.
Sunday, I want Sunday dinner. I want dinner.
And cheers to all our new friends and old friends. Happy Holy Thursday.
And we are talking, of course, about April the 29th. It's not too far away. At 10 a.m. on WYES TV, 26 half hours. Oh, my goodness. Your family, Terry Landry, Jim Moriarty, Lenny Delbert, what a team. It's
yes.
been so much fun working together. Absolutely. They've worked so hard. Well, let's talk about what's going on with this show and some of the very familiar faces that we saw. Cleo mm-hmm. has been around a long time, and she is a niece of your grandmother.
Yeah, she's my grandmother's niece. Her mom and my grandmother are sisters. And Cleo has been the one that's been by my grandmother's side the longest. So I had the pleasure of learning from both growing up.
Oh, my goodness. And then Zoe is like the fifth generation.
Zoe's the fifth generation, my niece, coming right behind us and keeping us going.
And then Eve, of course, she is a granddaughter, is
yes,
that correct?
Yes, Eve is a granddaughter, part of the fourth generation. And yes. she really honed into my grandfather's side of being at the bar and doing all the mixology and creating our beverages. So she runs that department.
Yeah. And it all goes back to Leah. And if you did not have the pleasure of getting to know Miss Leah, you know, 90 years plus,
yes.
okay, and her birthday being on January the 6th,
yes.
You know, what an amazing, amazing lady. But this is, I love the name of the show, The Legacy, you know. And yeah, to put together 26 half hours, tell us what can we can expect.
You know, the beautiful thing about this show and those 26 series, it really tells you the story of Dooky Chase from its very humble beginnings as a bar and a sandwich shop. So, of course, we dive into po' boys. And then we go through that whole era, through civil rights and all the way up into the fifth generation. And we tell that story through food and through the dishes. So not only is it a culinary school of Dooky Chase and how I grew up and learned, but we also added beverages to it to honor my grandfather and Eve Marie, who's now running the beverage department. So you get the both of the cuisine that tells our story of 82 years now. We've been in business for 82 years. So it starts
Avenue.
All the way through from Orleans Avenue. Uh-huh. And we added beverages to it.
And we should point out the mellifluous tones of Chase Kamada,
yes.
who is a granddaughter. And she is the narrator. You don't see her on camera, but she's ever present. And she is a very, as you know, Alan, you know, tracing her career, very talented actress, singer,
the first
and
Stage Door Idol winner. The very first one.
At World War II Museum?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah.
That is just great. Also, we should point out something really exciting. There already was, in 1990, in Pelican Publishing, the Dooky Chase Cookbook. All right? But now it's being expanded in conjunction with the series. So 81 more recipes, so 252 recipes
That's
in
correct.
This book, which includes the drink recipes too.
Certainly. So every recipe a part of the series, the food and the beverages, along with the other 100 plus recipes we had in there. So it's a great story.
Now you may have noticed, we just showed you the WYES website. What's very, very cool about this is that if you order a cookbook in there, I understand they're available now. Dook will sign it if you order it through WYES, and it Ooh. Also helps WYES. So that's really, really special
yes.
too. But we should always point out, it all goes back to the restaurant. I was there Holy Thursday, and so were many, many other people. But Orleans Avenue, beautiful inside. I know your grandmother so loved local art, especially by black artists.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful, beautiful restaurant. It came up after Katrina. What a story. That's a whole other story
right.
Of survival. But congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Really, really exciting. And we will talk about a new venture that you have a little bit later. So
yeah,
we're excited
certainly.
For that, too. But once again, Saturday, April 29th, 10 a.m., moving over to Vance. And you and Dook have known each other for a little while, right?
Yes. Our two families have been connected over many years, and I've watched him grow. I'm a little older, even though he looks better. I'm a little older.
Well, let's see. Your family, in the terms of sausage, only goes back to 1899, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
and which is truly amazing in the Seventh Ward. And what I'm excited is I've long known of you know, the Vaucresson sausage, and who doesn't? But also, I'm really excited because you now have a Creole Deli that's also, you can go and buy your sausage, but you can also go and have lunch on St. Bernard Avenue
yes.
at North Roman, correct?
St. Bernard and North Roman, right
yeah.
on the corner.
But you have been extra busy. We're going to show pictures of that, but also these festivals. I saw you at French Quarter Festival. I said, Vance, look up. And I took your picture. And your beautiful wife, Julie, was there, too. You all had quite a weekend.
We did. It was French Quarter Festival celebrated its 40th anniversary this year. And it has become one of the country's leading festivals, serving the community and also being an ambassador for the French Quarter and Bourbon Street and all that the French Quarter has to offer and bringing people to showcase that area again.
There you are at French Quarter Fest, and you were right in the heart of Jackson Square. I'm sure Saturday was a little hard because it got wet, didn't it?
Yeah, we had a torrential downpour, but Oof. You know, you just have to roll with it when you do these outdoor festivals.
You just got to keep on going, and there's a beautiful Julie, and that is actually at your Creole Deli on St. Bernard Avenue. It's just really a few blocks away from St. Bernard Circle, too. Too, right
yes,
there.
A few blocks down. My mm-hmm. grandfather was a butcher by trade, and he was in a public stall at the St. Bernard Market. And when it became privatized and became the Circle, he kept his meat market in the neighborhood to serve his constituents.
Yes.
And so we've
so
always been in the
it is meat there, and there's Sonny, your dad's
yeah.
Nickname was Sonny. You have show and tell, sir, right here, and
yes.
it smells So good. If you would, let's tilt this a little bit and show. You've got a sausage platter. This is so beautifully typical of Vaucresson sausage. Tell us about those flavors and the mustards, too.
Yes. Well, we've expanded our flavor offerings. We have our quintessential Creole hot sausage, known culturally as chorizo, that we have served to Dooky Chase's restaurant for many years. And we have a jerk chicken sausage, which we'll be featuring at the festival this weekend, as well as a Creole chicken sausage, which is a chicken-based sausage that we try to give different than beef and pork, give different options to our customers.
And you've gone into the mustard biz, too.
And we've gone into the mustard biz. We got to where we developed comparable mustards to go with the sausages. We have a mango mustard, our own Creole mustard. We have a Creole green onion sauce. My wife, Julie, came up with these recipes and really worked diligently to perfect them. And now we're also having a line of mustards, hopefully soon, in the grocery stores.
And you've got, I've had lunch at your place a few times, and you've got boudin balls, too.
Those are really delicious. We have boudin balls. You know, when boudin and some of the Cajun culture came into New Orleans and was popularized, some of those things were very familiar to us. Boudin to us is like Creole rice dressing. Uh-huh. So it's just another way of putting it together. So we serve that form of the boudin balls, and we're going to have some other wonderful staples to be added to the deli menu.
There they are. Those are really delicious. And, you know, what I also love is this history, because I remember way back when, on an early date, my husband and I, we went to Vaucresson's Creole Cafe on Bourbon Street. Yes. And your dad had that for about 10 years, huh?
About 10 years, 624 Bourbon, which is now the Paddle Bryan's Annex Bar.
65 to, like, 75 or something like that.
Something like that.
Yeah.
And you know, it was his partner, Larry Bornstein, had the building, and they decided to open up a restaurant in the quarter, representative of the Afro-Creole cooking traditions. And we were just fortunate enough, because a number of people who still to this day come by and see us at the cafe say that that was one of the first places they brought their dates. It was one of the places that some of the African Americans could actually dine in a place on Bourbon Street for the first time. So we were thankful to be able to provide that.
And just real quick, but there was also a very momentous occasion that took place there, too. Tell me about a conversation that spawned something very important.
Well, Larry Bornstein, who started Preservation Halls, had a dear friend in George Ween, who was the founder of the Newport News Jazz Festival and the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival. And he was in town from the Newport News Jazz Festival, and at that meeting was my dad having lunch with Alan Jaffe, who was the manager of Preservation Hall at the time, George and Larry, and they were talking about Newport News, and they asked, well, how come New Orleans does not have its festival highlighting jazz and its beautiful history and the culture? And George left that meeting and got with Quint Davis and Allison Miner and created the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival and asked us to be a food vendor. And we just have been there ever since.
And what I love, and, you know, certainly a restaurant provides lots of employment for young people. Mm-hmm. And my understanding is that the very talented director of One More Time and so many other things, an actor, Vernell Bonneries, was actually a waiter at Vaucresson for a while.
Vernell Bonneries was a waiter. I believe Jason, one of the owners of
Jason Patterson.
Patterson, right? Was so. A waiter at the restaurant. And then also, one of our maitre d's at the time, she always reminds me, was from Upper Line.
Joanne Clevenger. Oh,
Clevenger,
my goodness.
She worked at the restaurant as well.
So we're
just thankful. And so many things came out of there. We even had a young artist who was highlighted there doing a lot of the Preservation Hall Jazz series, Noelle Rockmore, who did a lot of paintings that are just quintessential to the art scene in New Orleans.
All right. Thank you so much. And once again, Vaucresson, you can go to their website, and they're at 1800 St. Bernard Avenue. Some delicious food. You can buy sausage there, of course, first and foremost, but also there's a great cafe. And you have some sausage at Dad Dog's these days, too.
Yes.
Huh?
Mr. John Georges, his father was good friends with my dad, and we were always had a relationship. And so when he started Dad Dog, he says, I have to have some Vaucresson sausage on the menu. So we created our version of our hot sausage that he has on the menu to this day.
All right, great. Thank you so much. And moving on to Alan.
All right, well, we're going to start back a little bit further than Vaucresson sausage. In 1851, an article written for DeBow's Review that was published here in New Orleans, Dr. Samuel Cartwright, a physician, came up with a pseudoscientific term he called drapetomania. Now, drapetomania was from two Greek words, from drapetes, runaway slaves, and mania, madness. And that was his explanation for the reason why Southern slaves felt the need to flee the safety of their masters' hearths and servitude. I can imagine that. Writing during the solitude and uncertainty of the pandemic, especially with consideration of the riots going on, the Black Lives Matter movement, playwright M.D. Schaefer thought about this particular pseudoscientific term, and he brought a bunch of millennial characters together, Wayne, played by Jay Dorsey, and Maggie, played by J.C. Domingue, as young parents trying to weather the pandemic and, of course, the racism that is rampant. It's easy to see the folly of really such a dehumanizing and objectifying language using the modern reason and, of course, what we all know of compassion as countermeasures to the theories that Carpenter held. But Donye Asante plays a playwright called KMS. He breaks that fourth wall and launches into essentially a play we have called Drapetomania, a Negro Carol. Yes, he uses ghosts, just like Dickens used ghosts in A Christmas Carol. Under his theatrical conceit, figures from the past, L.D. Barkley, played by Justin William Davis, who died at the 1971 Attica prison riot, and Georgiana Anna Simpson, that's Gwendolyn Foxworth, the first former slave to receive a doctorate in philosophy, came back as ghosts. Also, later abolitionist John Brown, played by Jonas Chartok, who, of course, died at Harper's Ferry prior to the outbreak of hostilities in World War, in the Civil War. They attempt to convince Wayne that they must join the cause and install him as their new hero to help save his people. Gwendolyn Foxworth as Miss Anna is a diminutive force of nature and fiercely proud of her accomplishments. She convinces Wayne he must take part in a ritual that will install him as a leader for his people, but she warns him there's much pain associated with that responsibility. And she serves as a witness while L.D. Barkley and John Brown tag team him in a ceremony that's designed to bring him more closely in contact with the spirit of his people and also provide him with an eventual insight that will forge him as a leader of his times. Well, Drapetomania is well directed by David Cote, an award-winning director who hails from Atlanta. The second act finds a trajectory of the play kind of losing momentum. Ultimately, the play spins out of control, but the question remains, did anyone ever fully have control over this one, especially with a title like Drapetomania? Like Samuel Carpenter's treatise, this play is a farce. It attempts to broach some very serious topics, however. Drapetomania, A Negro Carol, is at the New Play Works of the No Dream Deferred group that they're having at the New Works Festival. Again, No Dream Deferred is putting on this beautiful opportunity for people to come together, and it's at the old St. Rose of Lima.
On Bayou Road,
2541. Uh-huh. The next piece they're going to have coming up is called The Defiance of Dandelions. This will be the third, and I'll say the final of the large plays that they're going to be doing. This is going to be in the, I guess you might call it the ante room that they used to have where the bar is, and that's going to again be on, and again we remind everybody they have one more play that's going to be closer towards the end of May and June. It's going to be a reading, and that'll be on for a few days. Now, also going on, the new season was just announced for JPAS. We want everybody to know what's going on with that. JPAS is launching their brand new season, and we'll start off with what's going to be going on with their group. First off, we have a play that's called The View Upstairs. This is based on the Upstairs Lounge, which was here in New Orleans. Oh. This is for the LGBTQ community, of course. And you'll be able to learn about a little bit of, it's set in New Orleans. This is going to be a brand new play, September the 8th through the 17th at the JPAC on Airline Drive. Then, of course, Robert Harling's epic work, Steel Magnolias, will be at the Westwego Cultural Center. And, of course, you'll get to see that in Westwego. I can't wait to see a full orchestra with Mel Brooks' Young Frankenstein, which is going to be debuting October the 27th through November the 5th. That'll be back at the JPAC on Airline Drive. And, of course, anyone who knows Tallulah Bankhead knows there's a list of stories that you could go through, a litany of stories that will be really about her. This will be a lot of fun. Famous stories about her eyeballs and bathroom stalls and one of the greatest stage actors. You know, she won a Tony Award for The Skin of Our Teeth. So keep in mind that's going to be on at the Westwego Cultural Center. And then Katori Hall's powerful work on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It shows his warts and all, but it's really a wonderful work, The Mountaintop, January 25th through February the 4th at the Westwego Cultural Center. And, of course, Katori Hall has gone on to fame on Broadway as a great writer as well. And, of course, bringing back the musicals, we don't want to forget Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice's Jesus Christ Superstar will be at the JPAC on Airline Drive. That'll be on March 15th through the 24th. And, finally, the British farce Noises Off, written by Michael Frayn, will be on at the JPAC as well. And that's always a lot of fun. If you've ever seen it, Peggy, I know you probably have. It's just hysterical. The Kippers and everything else. One last thing. I would be remiss if I did not mention the fact that Phantom of the Opera has finally closed on Broadway after nearly 14,000 performances. This is a picture from the closing night with Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber, Andrew Lloyd Webber and Sir Cameron McIntosh there, along with Sarah Brightman, his first Christine Daae. It's unfortunately come to an end, but I have a feeling it will return.
Yes, I think so. Thank you, Alan. What with French Quarter Festival and the upcoming Jazz Fest, April is quite the musical month. Tonight, we spotlight the most famous New Orleans jazz musician of all. Here is my most recent piece of the past. I'm Peggy Scott Laborde with a piece of the past. We're taking a look at New Orleans history through some photos from my collection and local photographers and archives. Jazz great Louis Armstrong spent his first 21 years in New Orleans. Fortunately, he met some people along the way who became mentors. Growing up in poverty with his mother Mayanne and sister Beatrice, little Louis had a variety of jobs, including working for the Karnofsky family, who helped him purchase a cornet. As a child, his neighborhood included South Rampart Street, where he and friends sang on the street for change.
My Brazilian beauty, that was an early tune on the Amazon. That's where my lover's gone, gone, gone.
He ended up being arrested on New Year's Eve, 1912, for shooting off a gun. He was sent to what was known of as the Colored Waves Home. Music teacher Peter Davis put together a band there and gave lessons. Louis eventually became the group's leader. Jazz funerals and parades put on by local social aid and pleasure clubs were a common sight in the 1910s. Louis got to know local band leader Joe King Oliver, a cornet and trumpet player, who took the now teenager under his wing. Armstrong began playing around town and caught the ear of pianist Faith Marable, who hired musicians for the Streckfest line of Mississippi riverboats that featured jazz. It was during his time on the riverboats that Louis learned how to read music. It was also a chance to travel beyond New Orleans. In 1922, he received a telegram from King Oliver, who had moved to Chicago a few years earlier to play at the Lincoln Gardens Dance Hall and Nightclub. Oliver had a job for his protege. With his suitcase, music instrument, and a fish sandwich from his mom, Louis boarded a train, and of course, the rest is American music history. That's a piece of the past from WYES. Thanks for watching. All righty, special thanks to Mike Kaler for his editing on that. And check out more pieces of our past on WYES's YouTube channel. Time for picks. Dook, you've got a new restaurant.
I do. Chapter 4. We open at 1301 Gravia Street, Monday through Friday from 8 to 3, and Sunday brunch from 9 to 3. It's been going really, really well.
And this is the old Warwick Hotel right across from City Hall.
That's correct.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right. You're going to be at the Jazz Fest as tradition.
Yes, 54th. We're going to be there. Booth number 1. We're taking the space of the crawfish bread people that are no longer with them. And we're just going to go ahead and usher in a new chapter that we can feel will be just as exciting.
Congratulations. Thanks. Alan.
Well, a couple of things. First off, I want to remind everybody that next week, Chawa will be the guest at the Jazz Shabbat at Touro Synagogue. I might mention that next week as well because it'll be the day before. But LPO, the Louisiana Philharmonic Orchestra, having their Swing in the Oaks. Yay. And this is going to be at the Peristyle, the Great Lawn. Bring your lawn chairs, bring your blankets, bring your snacks. It's going to be wonderful for you to go out there and check out the scene there. And again, it'll be the last opportunity to see Carlos Prieto, who of course will be retiring as our musical director, but more good things to come from the LPL.
Absolutely.
I'll see you at the theater.
Okay, now my picks. The New Orleans Ballet Association presents the State Ballet of Georgia, the country, that is, this Saturday at the Mahalia Jackson Theater for the Performing Arts. Go to nobadance.com for tickets. On Saturday, check out a sneak preview of the first episode of a reboot of Henry Fielding's novel, Tom Jones, to debut on Masterpiece Theater on WYES April 30th. We will be serving bottomless mimosas and breakfast bites starting at 10:30 a.m. on Saturday at WYES with an 11 a.m. showing on our giant screen in our studio. Tickets are just $25. Go to wyes.org/events. On Monday, the Friends of Music present the Chamber Music Society of Lincoln Center with a program of music by Brahms and Dohnanyi at Dixon Hall. Go to eventbrite.com. Pre-performance lecture at 6:30. And Wednesday, wear your favorite hat to the Heart of the Park, a city luncheon at City Park, at the Botanical Garden. The event supports City Park and also community programs of the New Orleans Town Gardeners. Thank you all so very much, and thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Steppin Out is made possible in part by Susie and Pierre G. Villery.
With a continued passion for public television, we are proud to underwrite Steppin Out.
Please join us in supporting WYES Television.
The New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation promotes, preserves, and perpetuates music, culture, and heritage through programs, cultural, educational, and economic activities year-round. Learn more at jazzandheritage.org. The American Italian Cultural Center and Museum on South Peters in New Orleans offers event venue space, Italian language classes, dual citizenship and translation services, seminars, genealogy, and trips to Italy. Ciao, AmericanItalianCulturalCenter.com. This program is brought to you in part by the Eugenie and Joseph Jones Family Foundation, a local foundation proud to support education, the arts, and culture in the greater New Orleans area.